things that you bring to the table that will help you explain your idea well. So a little bit about me. My name is Leah. I'm currently a UI designer at the Museum of Science, and I graduated from MIT almost 6 years ago, so class of 2012. I was also not course 6, I was course 4. My senior year, I started to get really interested in web design and development. Didn't really know how to get started. I actually took my first web design classes at Mass Art, so like I would leave MIT in the night to like go to art school to learn coding, which was like kind of weird, but it ended up working out. So I started as an intern there at the museum, and now I've been here for 2 years now. So what do you want to get out of a wireframe? So what I would recommend is focus on getting as much information about your complex idea in one minute. So a lot of the things I'm going to show you today are drawings by hand. I just want to put out there before you like make any assumptions about your own drawing abilities that UI design is really not about being an artist, being a designer. It's really more about the learning process, more analytical process, and anyone can draw. At the same time, if you're coming to this course for more of a design background and you're coming here to learn the coding, it's also like a really good entry point because you've already heard more familiar drawing. So let's get started. So I have an example here. This is an app that I really want to build. Maybe I'm like lazy or too busy, but I always have problems in my kitchen with like buying food and then having it go bad and like just forgetting I have it in my fridge. So I was thinking, so I actually started a whiteboard on my fridge where every time I buy something, I like write down what it is, when I got it. That way I have an idea of like what's in there and what I should use first. So in this wireframe, you can see there are a few food items. I tell you how much there is, a bunch, two oranges, when I added them, how many days I have left to use them. And you'll also notice that the items that are going bad the sooner are at the top. So there's something about sorting going on here too. On the right, there's this like scroll bar, which shows that there's more in this database than just these three items. There's also this little add item button, which tells you you can add an item. And I don't know if you can see it, it's really small, but there are these little like pen symbols next to the item to tell you, oh, I can edit this item later. So, all right, here's an example of more of like an internal screen. So I have apples that I'm adding, excuse me, and they're four in the fridge, and I'm adding them today on January 12th, 2018. So I can click add, and it'll go into my fridge. There's also this little X button on the upper right, which shows that I can get out of the screen if I want it, so I'm not trapped here. In the second example, I have an update screen, so it tells me, oh, I have four items in my fridge, I can decrease it so that I only have two. Update it. So what are the key elements in a wireframe? So we kind of talked about some of them. Size, how many items I can fit in my database indicated by some of these UI elements on the screen. Functionality, so I know that I can add or edit an item. Navigation is something that didn't really apply for this example, but if you think about a website like Amazon, which has a gigantic navigation at the top, you know, okay, this is a really big website versus a blog where there's just an about page and a blogs page. There really isn't that much content there. Dynamic elements, I'm going to skip that, so we're going to talk about that later. And then context. So if I show you a screen, will you know if it's the home screen or if it's an internal page? Something like a breadcrumb trail, which is like one of those things where it like shows like the little arrows so you know how deep you are in the site. Something like that's helpful to draw out, or even something like a back button or a really good context. If there's like any doubt, if you have any doubt in your mind that your reviewer is not going to know where you are in an app, one thing you can do, which I've done here just on this slide, is have the title of your idea, colon, and then what screen it is. That way they can look at it and look back and forth and say, okay, we're on the main screen. But ideally, your drawing should give them an idea without the labels, but this is just something you can do. So I just wanted to show a couple examples of ideal wireframing layouts. This is an example of if I were to have some sort of dynamic guest list. There are two things that you can notice from this screen. One, you can see that the guests are organized by alphabet. So these are the first screen, which is A, B, and C. There are also two navigation options, next and last. So next would take you to D, E, F, and last would take you to X, Y, Z. And then you have everything in between. So just from this one picture, I know that there's not just like one screen of names, there may be like 10, however many it would take to go from A to Z. So just like in one screen, a lot of them would. Another tip I have is, so there may be cases in your project where you have some sort of effect that really relates to the interaction in the browser, so something like a hover effect. If you were to do a hover effect like on in the browser and screenshot it, you wouldn't see that little arrow. You would just see like all these boxes kind of disembodied. So that's kind of confusing if you don't have the context. So similarly, in a wireframe, it's really good to just like draw out that arrow if it's going to be a hover effect, so you have this more complete picture about what the interaction is. So in my list earlier, one of the items was dynamic elements. So I want to talk to you about this idea of statefulness. So if you just Google like UI states, you'll get a bunch of stuff. Like states could be something like nothing is selected, everything is selected. You can proceed, you can't proceed. There are just like infinite possibilities for what it could be. A loading screen is also a state. It's really important to think about these states before you get too far in your project. One, because it really paints a picture of the full experience, and two, you'll get a better idea of everything you need to code later. So great to have that as an advance. A few examples. This first one is an online store where there are different ribbons. So some of the ribbons tell you that items have a discount, and then this red one tells you it's sold out. So there are two helpful takeaways from this picture. One, if something is sold out, it's going to tell you it's sold out rather than disappear from the screen, which is helpful. Another thing that's helpful is to know you're going to have to build these ribbons and then have them in two different colors. So, but the ribbons look the same, so maybe you would use like the same CSS class for the ribbon and then just add like a green class or red class for the different types. So again, leaning ahead to the coding is always great when you can do that. This next example, this is a really common thing you'll see in any kind of like digital interactive work. There's like some sort of status indicator. So this is where we are in the lecture, about halfway through. This is called a loading bar or a graphical pipeline. You see it a lot in like progress for making an order or something like progress for an online course. Again, you can just look at this and get information even without these words. Get a sense, all right, almost half, a little over halfway through. This also comes in like a gaming context. So if you're playing some video game, you have all these units, how do you know which ones are your attack? Well, there's probably some message, right? Or maybe some items are highlighted. So another example. So a big question that comes up in wireframing is, what words do I put on the screen? Do I use that like lorem ipsum dummy text? Do I put in real context? Like, do I even know what it's going to say? So I have a couple tips for you. One, stay away from any kind of jargon that's technical. Like, if you have a graph, don't say D3 graph. It should be really clear what it is to someone with no technical background. The label I've given, so this is a little sketch of like a graph where you're looking at some data, you're sorting the data. And the caption I've given the graph is graph showing owl population sizes for selected types and time range. So this caption is effective for two reasons. One, it's general enough that I can change things about that graph later. So I don't have to decide, oh, like it's going to be like a scatter plot or a bar graph. Like that, how it looks doesn't really matter, it's what it is. Another thing is I'm not adding in info about like what's on axes, because I might not want to change that. I might want to change that later. And then also, again, it just stays away from that jargon. It's just a graph. What's in the graph? So so back to this idea about like my argument for why you should stay away from more missile text if possible is because sometimes if you have content laid out in advance, it can give you some more, it can give you a deeper dive into how you organize your app. So say you have an online app where you're building a pizza and you're choosing different toppings, and then after you check the boxes, get a graphic of what you're going to get. So this wireframe is like a B plus, I would create it wireframe. Like it tells you, like you get a sense of what interaction is here, but you don't know what the items are. So say you don't know what the exact toppings are going to serve are. If you just start writing out some ideas, I just like really love quickly, pepperoni, onion, garlic, steak, you can already see that they start to kind of fall into categories, vegetables and meat. So just between these two screens, this one is already so much better because it gives you that idea of like how you want to do the layout and also some idea about content and functionality. So I may decide, hey, I want to ask people what are their preferences before I even get them to that screen where they're selecting things so that they don't have to see things that they're not interested in. So having content in there where you may have put placeholder text could lead you to change the whole user experience of your app in a really positive way. And again, you're not tied to whatever content is in your wireframe, but just like getting something there to give people a clear idea and give yourself a clear idea is always great. So the last thing I'm going to present on is this idea of craft. So craft, by craft, I mean how you're making your wireframes. As you've seen, a lot of these have been hand drawn. They're like a little messy. They have a little like bit of cartoonish, a little bit of a style. You probably have seen some sort of like more digital sketches done in Photoshop, which is always a possibility. However, I would really recommend you stick at least at the beginning with just hand drawings, because when you're doing that, the flow of ideas is clear. When you get into Photoshop, you're thinking about, you're forced to choose a text size, you're forced to pick a font, and you introduce all these other decisions that you don't really have to do. Like if you're just sketching by hand, you're not like, what's the font size of this? You just do it and you have those ideas and it flows and you can iterate more quickly. Just for due diligence, I did make one of the screens from earlier in Photoshop. It took me like a half hour, which it shouldn't have because I was, you know, getting involved in some of the like minutia of like just having more options. So if you compare it, I'll just like click quickly back and forth between the two. The only thing I would say is like significantly better about this is that the title of the app is like receded and gray versus here. The title is like huge because it was the first thing I put on the page and I was really excited about it. And it's like, you know, toned down a little bit. And the most important thing is really to work with line weight. So if you have something like a set of pencils, a black pen, and a Sharpie, that will really like help you go a long way. Because when you have anything that's like more elevated, like a pop-up box that has a higher Z index, you want to draw attention to that. So something like a Sharpie will be your best friend. All the stuff that's like in the background that you maybe don't want to look at, but you still want to indicate is happening in the background, like this grid, you have a really thin line. And that tells you a lot about what's important, what should I be looking at. If you do want to go into some more like digital styling, here are a few options. I would recommend Sketch because it's free and they have a 30-day trial. Which goes really well with like the length of this course. Photoshop is good, I use that most of the time. Balsamic is one of the more popular ones. I haven't actually used it, but something that's good about programs like this is you can reuse different elements. Like I know Balsamic has like a library of buttons that you can use. You don't have to make your own button, you can just like drag in a bunch of things. It can also be good if you're just gonna make new copies of some more things. You don't have to like hand draw it and like rescan it every time. But I would say just like go to Liberty's and buy some Sharpies. It's spend all your time working on really good CSS in your final app and really focus these first ideas on content. So, key points again. Put as much information on an image. Explain as much as possible. Flesh out all those details. Know what you're going to be coding later. Content reveals functionality, so be as specific as you can, even if it will change. And lastly, everyone can draw and enjoy the process. Save all of the early sketches you do, one, because it's really cool to look at them after you've built the full app. And second, say you're applying to some internship or job or graduate school after this course, you can use like screenshots of the real prototype and the early wireframes and just create like a whole case study and like walk someone through that example and say a job interview or put it in, you know, a digital portfolio. It'll really serve you very well. So I hope this was helpful. Have a lot of fun. I also put my contact info up here. If you have any questions about UI design, about museums, I work in that context, about web development, or just like after MIT, just shoot me an email. I'm happy to chat with you. Thank you.